In this lesson, we're going to learn about estimation and confidence intervals. And the idea behind a confidence interval is if we estimate something, we want to know how confident we can be that the value that we've come up with is correct. Are we 95% confident, 90%, 50%? So we'll learn a little bit more about that as we continue on here. In previous lessons, we've already learned that a sample mean is an estimate of the population mean, and that's the case with every sample statistic. We call those point estimates. So point estimate is a single value derived from a sample, and we use that to estimate the population value. An estimate is just that, an estimate. So what we'd like to do with our point estimate is we'd like to be able to develop an interval estimate, a range of values. So a confidence interval estimate is a range of values constructed from the sample data so that the population data will likely occur within a specific level of confidence within that value. So if we, for instance, end up with a mean of 21.2, we would like to know the range of that 95% likelihood that the population values will actually fall within. So our confidence interval, or the range of values that the population parameters likely fall within, plus or minus the mean, you can see the formula is very, very easy. It's simply x bar, your sample mean, plus or minus z times the standard error. And of course, the standard error of the mean is the standard deviation of the population divided by the square root of n, the number in the sample. Now, in order for this to work, notice up at the top of the slide it says when standard deviation of known is known. So if we know the standard deviation of the population, this is the formula that we will use. The z-score that we use is actually going to be the z-score for the confidence level, the desired level of confidence that we'd like. So we're going to have to look up the z based on the percentage of confidence that we want. And you'll see that in the next slide here. Well, this slide tells us how we determine what z value we're going to use. And in this case, with the example, we're interested in a 95% confidence level. That means that we have 2.5% at each side or each tail of the distribution. So that would mean 2.5% on the left, 2.5% on the right. Remember that from the mean to the far left or the far right, each half is 0.5. So if we're going to take 0.5 minus the 2.5% on each end for the 95% confidence level, we would then know that the value from the mean to the z-score we're looking for is 0.475. And of course, if we look that up in the table, 0.475 ends up with a z-score of 1.96. And that is a z-score that you might want to commit to memory, 1.96 for the 95% confidence level with a two-tail distribution, in other words, both sides. So here we have an example of how we can actually use the confidence interval and develop it. So what we want to know is we want to know what the population mean is. So we have the American Management Association. They've done a random sample of 256 managers, and they have come up with a sample mean of 45,420. They happen to know, for some reason, that the population standard deviation is 2050. So what we'd like to know here is, what does the population mean? Well, of course, we don't know that, so we're going to use the 45,420, the sample mean, as a point estimate. But we'd also like to know what the confidence interval, in other words, in within what range, plus or minus the 45,420, 95% of the managers would lie. So once again, we see how to come up with the z-score, and the z-score of 0.475 is 1.96. Remember I said that's one you might want to commit to memory. If we were using Excel, the Excel function would be norms_env, and then of course the value within the tail, which in this case is 2.5%. That would also come up with the z-score of 1.96. Alright, once we have the z-score that we need, the 1.96, we already knew what the standard deviation is, we know what n is, now we can go ahead and compute the margin of error. So, using that formula, 1.96 times 2050 divided by the square root of 256, we end up with a margin of error of 251. So, our confidence limit, or the confidence interval, would be 45,169 and 45,671. So that means if we pulled samples 95 out of 100 times, we would end up hitting the real population mean between those two values, 45,169 and 45,671. So here's the official interpretation of our confidence interval. So if we select many, many, many samples of 256 managers, and we compute their 95% confidence interval. About 95% of those confidence intervals will actually contain the real population mean. But at the same time, about 5% of those would not. So we have a 95% confidence level that if we pull a sample mean, the actual population mean would be contained within that confidence interval. Now remember, one of the requirements to use the confidence interval formula that we just saw was that we have the population standard deviation, which enables us to use the z-score. Most of the time when we do a sample, we're really not going to have the population mean or the population standard deviation. So in those cases, we're going to use a different test statistic, and that test statistic is going to be the t rather than the z. This is a quick comparison of the distribution of a Z versus a distribution of T. You'll notice that T is a little bit wider, a little bit more spread out, a little bit more information in the tails. And so basically what that means to us is that if we're going to use a 95% confidence level, the T score is going to be quite a bit higher than the Z score. Notice with this example here, 1.96 is the Z score for the 95% confidence level, but that same confidence level with a T, because it's flattened out, the distribution's flattened out, would be 2.776. So I guess the easiest thing to remember about this is that when you're computing T scores, they will be a little larger than the Z scores. So here's an example of how we're actually going to compute a confidence interval using a T rather than a Z. So a tire manufacturer wishes to investigate the tread life of its tires. They took a sample of 10 tires, and they were all driven 50,000 miles. And that revealed that there was a mean of 0.32 inches of tread remaining. The standard deviation, now this is not the standard deviation of the population, but the standard deviation of the sample was 0.09. So we'd like to know what the 95% confidence interval is of the population mean. All right, the way we compute the margin of error with the T is very similar, except instead of using the standard deviation of the population, we use the standard deviation of the sample. So in this case, we have T, which we're going to look up. Then we also have the standard deviation of the sample divided by the square root of N. So in addition to working with the standard deviation of the sample, we also have to look up the T value for the 95% confidence level. And this is a little bit more confusing than looking up a value within a Z. So the first thing you're going to do is find the column. And you notice where it says confidence intervals, we have the 80%, 90%, and of course the 95 there in pink, 98, and 99. So that's the first thing we do is we look at the column, the 95% confidence interval. But then we also have to look at the degrees of freedom. Now in this case, the degrees of freedom are simply going to be N minus 1. So in this case, we had a sample of 10 tires, so the degrees of freedom is going to be 9. N minus 1 is 9. So we look at the degree of freedom 9 row, we look at the 95% confidence interval column, and we end up with a value of 2.262. And that's the T that we're going to use in our formula to compute the margin of error. Well, now we have all the values that we need to compute the margin of error and therefore the confidence interval. We have N equals 10, X bar is 0.32, the standard deviation of the sample 0.09. We looked up the T value of 2.262, we do the calculations and we end up with a margin of error of 0.064. So we add that to the sample mean, we subtract that from the sample mean, and we end up with a 95% confidence interval of 0.256 and the low end, and 0.384 on the high end. So here's a flow chart as to helping us decide whether we use the T or the Z. And so essentially it boils down to, do we know the population standard deviation? And if we do, we use the Z distribution, and if we do not, we use the T. It's that simple. The other thing that we might run into when we're sampling populations are proportions. Now remember, a proportion is going to use a nominal scale. So for instance, a proportion might be males in relation to the total population, females in relation to the total population, the number of students in the class that passed the test in relation to the total population. So the sample proportion, that's a formula you're already familiar with, is x, the number of the males divided by n, the total class or the total population. So the confidence interval for a population is a very simple formula as well. That formula is the proportion plus or minus z, and of course that z value, if you're using 95% confidence interval, would be 1.96, times the square root of the proportion times 1 minus the proportion divided by n. Let's run through an example of a confidence interval for a proportion. So here's the example. The union representing the BBA is considering a proposal to merge with the Teamsters. According to BBA bylaws, at least 3/4, at least 75%, of the union membership must approve any merger. A random sample of 2,000 current BBA members reveals that 1,600 plan to vote. So what we'd like to do is we would like to develop a confidence interval, a 95% confidence interval for the population, to see if we took the vote, if we thought we would be in favor of merging. Okay, so our first step is to compute the sample proportion. In this case, x is 1600 over the population of 2000. We end up with a sample proportion of 0.8. So we want to find the z value first for the 95% confidence interval. We happen to know that already. That is 1.96, and then we're going to go ahead and compute the confidence interval, and we'll do that in the next slide. All right, once we plug in all the numbers here, we get a margin of error of 0.018. So our 95% confidence interval runs between 78.2 and 81.8. So we can say with 95% confidence that if we go ahead and hold the vote, at least 75% of the members would go ahead and vote for the merger.